So now it is 8 a.m. So we would like to, today we would like to start a topic about tools to study information in clinical setting. And we would like to invite Associate Professor Porn Pan Vivitthanaporn. She is Associate Professor in the Department of Play Clinic at CNMI, Ramathibadi Hospital. And Dr. Porn Pan is got a bachelor's degree in pharmaceutical science from Chulalongkorn University Hospital, and then she graduated for PhD in pharmacology from University of Texas Medical Branch, Galveston, Texas, and after that she did postdoctoral fellow at the Department of Medicine, Medical Microbiology and Immunology, University of Alberta, Alberta, Canada. And actually her research area is about heavy metal induced inflammation and identical of natural compound to relieve inflammation or act as anti-cancer and also brain inflammation. So let's start.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. So it's actually a long time that I didn't give a talk in English. So I'm going to try to go slow. The topic of today is the study of inflammation in clinical setting. So when I first got the invitation, my research is actually not a lot about on the gynecology. We just start collaboration with Dr. Pia. So today it is my honor to show you some of the data, the primary data that we do. And when I choose the topic, I thought that this is something that I will show you that what I can do in my laboratory in CNMI, and that you might be have some idea that we can collaborate in the future. So inflammation is a big and wide area of the topic, and it also involves in many diseases. And the tool to study is actually you can apply to any of the organ, and there's a pro and con, there are pitfalls for some of them. So we're going to talk about several of inflammatory mediators today. So I'm trying to talk only the one that I work with already. So I have experience working on cytokine and chemokine. So this is the main when you talk about inflammation. Mostly people will think about interleukin-1, interleukin-6, and that's what my lab do. We can actually measure level of interleukin-6. We do it like regularly. So that's when we start the collaboration with Dr. Pia. So sometimes like you never know you're going to get some exciting thing to work on. And something when you talk a little bit on some like not like maybe like a chit chat, it can lead to like good and interesting project. So we talk about cytokine and chemokine. And then I also actually work on prostaglandin. It's not a lot. Actually, I'm not showing a lot of data today because a lot of people work on that. But I work on leukotriene and I have paper on that. So prostaglandin and leukotriene are also inflammatory mediator and it's play a role in like other disease too. And another thing is like I'm working on my lab is actually matrix metalloproteinase or MMP. So this thing that what work on in my lab, and when I'm start preparing the talk, I would like to be about like your guys. So I'm talking on the obstetric gynecology. So what I'm doing right now is the research in amniotic fluid. And this is like a new area for me. So like this is something that I never thought I would work on with, but it's very exciting. And so I have to research on it too. I know that they have some cytokine. So actually any liquid in the body, you can measure cytokine. And cytokine measurement is actually quite easy and also is quantitative. So when we start talking about that, we talk about start with Dr. Pia and the preterm matter. And we talk about measuring interleukin 6. And we're going to show you some little bit data. We didn't do it a lot yet because I want to make it like a big batch, like 20 people and measure one time. And so when I start preparing this, so I research some of the review and they show that actually in here, this is the picture of human amniotic fluid that they depict. They said that you can actually measure some of cytokine. And they mentioned interleukin-1, interleukin-18, that some of like the cytokine have both pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory one. So the liquid of the amniotic fluid can be measured all of them. Some of them might be below the detection limit, but you never know what you're gonna find. And so another thing we're going to show at the end of the talk today is actually we get some amniotic fluid, and we try to do that. Maybe we can measure and separate the type of the cells. So we start with some of the preliminary data. The reason we start that because I have some antibody in my lab, so just try it. It's not very difficult. So in here, I'm going to show you that amniotic fluid that they have inflammation. In this picture, they actually start with infection. You're going to saw T lymphocyte, you're going to find neutrophil, you can find monocyte, macrophage. All these cells, actually, if you send the lab, they probably give you some of the total number of white blood cell or total number of leukocyte. But what the research, if we can do, is actually we can tell you what type of the cell. And if we read and research a lot, we actually can maybe measure some of the inflammatory marker or some of the activation marker on this cell too. So this is what I show. And then in this paper, they also said that there's a change in prostaglandin. So maybe after like preparing this talk, maybe I would think like about maybe start some of the project on that. Another thing that was related to the inflammation is the degradation of extracellular matrix. So matrix metalloproteinase is something that we can actually measure. So this matrix metalloproteinase, when they degrade the extracellular matrix, they will lead to like the trigger of the problem. Like they can cause like endothelial mesenchymal transition. They can cause cell death. The tight junction will be loose, and there will be a lot of problem more. And matrix metalloproteinase, we can measure, and actually some of them will secrete it into the amniotic fluid. We might be able to actually measure it. And also the tissue will be very great if we can get it, but in the clinical setting, it's sometimes we cannot have all of them that we want. So we're gonna talk about all these mediators today. And when we talk about clinical setting, we need to about thinking about specimen that we can use to study. So the classic specimen is serum or plasma. So the serum or plasma, usually sometimes you can get a routine, and you can get, if you get a consent, this serum or plasma can be measured like cytokine, a lot of things. However, sometimes the correlation to the, like when I was doing research on my research on the brain. So the thing in plasma or serum is not very quite correlated to the cerebrospinal fluid. Sometimes it do related, sometimes it's not. So it's actually very good or like very excited opportunity when we can actually work on like specialized liquid like cerebrospinal fluid, or in this case, amniotic fluid. So this time, usually people study on serum or plasma. You can measure it and you can publish the data on that. Another thing that you can use is tissue. So I'm talking today because my talk have an experience on amniotic fluid, but I'm sure that there's cancer, that tumor, or there may be some biopsy tissue that you have to get. And all this, you can actually, if it's about cancer, there are a lot of research you can do. I'm going to show you at the end today that I have some research on meningioma. It's the project that I work with a doctor in the Prasad Neurological Hospital. So here, there's a classic example of the specimen that we can use to study inflammation. This specimen is quite easy to get sometimes. It's like a routine. So there are a lot of paper to that. And there's some unique one like amniotic fluid. So I'm going to show you some of my data. And in the talk that when talking with Dr. Pia, she also said that the thing that you guys do quite regularly is the vaginal fluid. So we talk about it, and I tell her that there's some limitation. But I also read up on when we start working on it and prepare for this talk is that actually people start using vaginal fluid more and more for the marker. One thing is that anything that we consider non-invasive is good. So there's a paper working on like you may be able to actually measure using the vaginal fluid to measure into leukin sick instead of doing amniocentesis. So that's something we can work on. However, I'm going to tell you later that some of the specimen may be a great way to that we think about is great, but sometimes it has some limitation. Like vaginal fluid, when I talk with Dr. Pia, she said, this is something we can do. I said, yes, it's very interesting. But when we start to measure something, we have to think about how we're going to compare between each person. And also one thing that will make your research like quite smooth is to think about how you collect your sample. Because if you collect it good, it's actually when we get the number, it's more easily to translate the data. And sometimes when we start doing something, we might think it's good, but along the way, you're gonna get that, oh, actually this is have to be changed a little bit. So one of the things that was a specimen to study is saliva. I actually work with a doctor in the psychiatry department. We're gonna start working on the saliva sample because it's considered non-invasive. And actually they are good way to measure stress marker. There are a lot of people think about stress marker already, and instead of trying to like get the plasma, we can actually have them spit the saliva into the tube and we can measure the biological response. There's a paper, this one just come out on 2020, that's talking about stress response in the woman with postpartum psychosis. And they talk about the role of inflammation and they measure cortisol in saliva. So I'm working on saliva already. So when we start working on it, I was very excited. When we start working on it already, we start finding some little bit problem. Like it's not easy to actually get saliva like 2-3 mL. And also the way that the patient or the volunteer have to spit, it have to be quite specific. Otherwise there'll be a lot of interference. However, it's like a unique and attractive technique. So I'm not showing the data on saliva right now because we just finished collecting sample for about 80 students. So this is something that you can think about it. One of the talk today is, one of the purpose of the talk is like to tell you that basic research is something that can support your research in your clinical setting. And this marker can make your research have more depth, and you also like can maybe like understand the pathological better. So here's the specimen that you can study the inflammation. And when I talk about like I do cytokine, I do prostaglandin, I do MMP, I'm gonna talk some technique. So I'm not gonna go detail on how to make ELISA because it's what I'm doing. We're not gonna ask you guys to actually come perform ELISA, but I'm gonna tell you that ELISA can be used for any of the liquid sample. If we get amniotic fluid, we get serum, we can perform and measure ELISA. And in ELISA, we can actually measure cytokine, we can measure prostaglandin, we can measure leukotriene or metric metalloproteinase. Sometimes we prepare some technique before much better than another technique. There are a lot of reasons for that. First reason is the convenience. The second of the reason is the price. So ELISA can be expensive. However, some of the standard one is rich, like it's not too bad. And if the lab actually do it a lot, like my lab, throwing some sample is not a big deal. So like interleukin 6, interleukin 8, we usually measure every other week at least for the like basic laboratory. So in here, we can do that. Actually, we can use ELISA to work on the information. We can do PCR. When we're gonna do PCR, actually, we would like to have some cells. So in amniotic fluid have cell, we didn't try this one yet, but because we do need quite a bit of cell for do that. However, if we actually have tissue, for tissue sample, it's actually more appropriate to do PCR because in ELISA, sometimes if you have to grab the tissue up, there's some error on that. So if you have tissue sample, the PCR will be better. And the PCR, because the biggest cost of PCR is the first step. After you do the first step already, you can do 20, 30 yin without big cost. So when actually I do some PCR, I will screen a lot. You can screen some for cytokine. You can screen for the cytokine receptor. And if we're talking about prostaglandin and leukotriene, what we do beside the receptor is we do try to find the enzyme that synthesizes it. Because like, if they have increased level of the enzyme, we can point out that they're probably gonna be more prostaglandin or more leukotriene. Another technique, if we get the tissue sample, is we can do Western blot. So the PCR are measuring the RNA. And for the scientific world, RNA is great. You can tell a lot of information on that, but it doesn't mean that every elevation of RNA will turn to be the protein that is the working unit. So if you can show the data for both PCR and both Western blot, which is measure protein, is it actually very great? It means that this thing do probably have more tendency to happen in the real life. And another technique we can do when we get tissue is immunohistochemistry. So in this way, we actually know that which type of cell are expressed, but some of these that have limitation depend on the quality of antibody. So the more popular protein, usually the company will develop good antibody. I work on the leukotriene, that some of antibody are good and some are really bad, and we don't be able to actually get the picture at all because the antibody will not buy. So the last thing that I'm showing you the data later is called cosmogram. It's a unique technique for the matrix metalloproteinase. MMP are degrading extracellular matrix, and we can actually like use some of the substrate, putting on a gel and put the liquid sample on it, and they will eat away the substrate if they have it. And so I'm going to show you some data that we can, that was on the cell culture. We can actually induce it. We put the drug and the result that it reduced. And that's some of the data I'm going to show you today. So here there's specimen and what type of the study of technique we can use. If I get serum or plusma, I can actually do some ELISA, measure the cytokine. And also we can actually get, if we get the blood, we actually can do some cell for flow cytometry. For the tissue, actually we will process to PCR, Western blot, or immunohistochemistry. I do process tissue for ELISA before, but I do it with the brain tissue. I found the results are very quite, fluctuated. So it's actually hard to interpret the data. So for amniotic fluid, we can do some ELISA and flow cytometry. I have very preliminary data to show you, but the reason I selected it because to show that this is the sample that we get from Ramathibodi Hospital. We send it to Ramathibodi Chakrinarubadin, which is like 2 hours after that, but we still can get some data. And the data look really nice if we get a very nice specimen. So then for vaginal fluid, in theory, we can do ELISA and PCR. So that's something after like preparing the talk, I actually interested a lot. But I think for vaginal fluid, there were going to be some work out on how to actually get the reliable data from the sample. So because the thing is like, if I get amniotic fluid, I get it in liquid. So I can actually give you the ELISA, which is I can give you the level of cytokine back in the unit, like nanogram per ml. And that nanogram per ml can be come from your amniotic fluid. Problem with the vaginal fluid is I will get the result in, I guess the specimen in swab. So the swab will have the like cotton. And also I don't know how much the cotton actually absorbs the liquid. However, I see the I read some through some of the paper. A lot of people use the same technique. So I guess it's quite acceptable in the field that we can use the swab, process the swab in the same way, and we can actually compare the data from each other. The vaginal fluid, actually, if we can do it, it will open a lot of opportunity to actually do some research. So I'm going to talk about what I'm doing before. So I'm not doing on the gynecology problem before. My research area is actually on brain. So my PhD is on neuroscience and work on the cell culture animal. When I get to the postdoctoral, I'm get lucky that my boss actually work on the brain and HIV. So my research experience expand to some of the brain tissue. When I get back, I do get some opportunity to work on the brain cancer. So some of the data I show you today are on cell culture. Some of the data on the brain tumor. So the first one, like Dr. Pia said, my research in here is actually focused on heavy metal. And the heavy metal can cause toxicity, but not only they can kill the cell, they can actually induce the inflammation. And the level that they induce inflammation is sometimes much lower than the level that kill the cell. So here I'm showing the data on cadmium, which is actually the heavy metal that can be contaminated in lots of space. And it have a long biological half-life, about 30 years. And the killing concentration is about, it depends on the tissue. So like in the, I'm working on here is astrocyte. So in astrocyte, about 30 micromolar can kill the cell. 20 to 30 micromolar can kill the cell easily in one day. But here I'll show you data that 1 micromolar or 10 micromolar is actually be able to induce the level of cytokine. So like I said before, PCR can measure the RNA level. It's great, you can do a lot of stuff, but you also actually have to prove in terms of the protein. So you can go proving in terms of like Western blood or even cytokine. We actually like to measure the release of the protein from the cell so we can use ELISA. So in here, I'll show that I had actually, if cadmium, put it on astrocyte, we will induce the level of interleukin 6 mRNA. We show the time that 3 hours and 6 hours, you see kind of the same effect. And then you actually measure the protein that released into the cell supernatant. And you can see that increasing the time, we have increasing level of the cytokine level. So the gray bar is 6 hours, the black bar is 24 hours. You can see that the level of interleukin 6 was increased. When we do cell culture, it's quite easily that much easier than doing the clinical setting because we can set the control. The control for us will be the non-treatment, which is we can see that we can have a baseline, we can have something else to compare with. So here we show that this is what I'm starting in here in Thailand, like that's 2017. I'm starting at Jacqueline Nurbuddin about 2 years ago. Previously, I was working at Faculty of Science. So actually I have a chance to collaborate with the doctor in the Prasad Neurological Hospital, a little bit chance to collaborate with Ramathipati, but the project doesn't really pan out very well at that time. So, this is what I do for ELISA, and that start like my research and the journey on the information. Another thing I work on is cancer. So this is not my work, but this is one of the rationale that we work on leukotriene. And maybe I can convince some of your colleagues to interested in this protein. So in 2016, there's a paper from Taiwan. They study the people who actually taking the Montelukast, which is leukotriene receptor antagonist. And they found that people who take that have a lower cancer risk. So in here, they show that, let me show you this picture first. The people who don't use Montelukast, and here is the people who use Montelukast. And here they show that people who don't use, and also all these are asthma patients who actually receive Montelukast as a part of the treatment, or the asthma patient who didn't receive it. So they show that if you don't receive Montelukast, the cumulative cancer incident of the patient for 10 years is as the red dot, as the red line. So there are some patients, quite significant amount, about 1/4 of the patient receive Montelukast as part of the treatment. And they found that they actually have a lower level of the cancer incident. They pinpoint some of the cancer. They didn't show the like uterine cancer, but they show lung, colorectal, gastric, or liver. So the reason that they didn't show specific some of the like uterine cancer, I think because there are limitation of the patient. However, I think there will be one study coming up from Korea showing almost a similar trend of the result, that people who take Montelukast regularly, they actually can reduce the cancer risk, but they also depend on how long and the concentration or the dose that they take. So in this study, we start my laboratory to research on like basic thing, what Montelukast can do. So I put it on because this one we're working on MMP, metric metalloproteinase. We select 2 and 9 because that's the most basic one that was playing a role in a lot of neurological disease. Here, what we show that if we put Montelukast on, you can see the band in the here is smaller. So metric metalloproteinase eat out their extracellular matrix. they have specific substrate called gelatin. We can actually put gelatin into the gel, and other gel have gelatin. So then we load the supernatant on, which is the liquid sample. We can load it on, and you'll see that they will eat away the gelatin. So there are more metric methylbuninase. You will see the bigger band on this side. And then if you have less metric methylbuninase, like the drug inhibited, you will see the band are getting thinner. So usually you will see the band and like we will stain the gel with the blue color. And if the metric methylbuninase present, we're going to see the white big band. Here is metric methylbuninase 2, which is constitutive. So they actually are present in the culture supernatant all the time. We also work on MPP9, which is an inducible isoform of metric methylbuninase. What we do is actually we have to induce it. So we induce it with inflammation, inflammatory cytokine interleukin 1. We found that we had actually activated it. And then when we put montelukast on, we can actually reduce the reduce the level of MMP9. So that's a technique that can do. Actually, I was thought that maybe we can try to apply this to amniotic fluid, because this is very like it's a very simple technique, but it can tell you that you have the MMP9 that functional in your sample or not. So one of the things with simogram is not only tell you the amount of protein, they tell you the amount of protein that actually have the enzymatic action. So they tell the function of the protein too. So here, this is something that we probably can do. And then we actually have a chance to work with the doctor from the Prasad Neurological Sample. Here we work on the cancer called meningioma. So meningioma, for me, when I start the project, I actually contact the my senior friend actually contact the doctor to ask for a sample for glioma. So glioma is a cancer for astrocyte, and I'm working on astrocyte, so it's something that matching. Along the way, when we talk to him, he said that I have a lot of meningioma sample. There are not a lot of people doing research on this. Could you please do some research for me? I was like, really, meningioma? Something very fibrous is probably not easy to work with. Previously, I worked on breast cancer with Ajahn Ronalat. It's very difficult to actually process a sample that have a lot of fat tissue, but we actually managed to get some data. So here with meningioma, we thought in the beginning that it's just a meninge, what we can do, what else we're going to see. So I'm asking him that one of the problem when I'm start working on other project already. So I start notice that in clinical setting, it's not like in cell culture that you can actually set the control. So when you get the sample for patient, you have to think about what you're gonna normalize to it. What is the normal for each of the patient? So what we do the best we can is that after talk with the surgeon, he said that along the way that he have to cut out the cancer, he also have to cut around the dura, which is look like normal tissue. And he said that he didn't have a lot because he have to be like very careful how much cut, but there's some area that he think is not cancer. And so we asked for that sample. We usually get it, but not always. So sometimes we only get the cancer part. Sometimes we get the adjacent area, and we call that adjacent non-cancerous dura. And also because it's a dura, which is probably not have a lot of cells. When we try to do PCR, we try to do measure protein RNA level. You have to have cell, you have to have mRNA in the cell to actually measure it. So when there are fibrous tissue, there are not a lot of them. So we actually get sample about, I think, 70 to 80 sample, but we only managed to get only 24 pair. So that's a lot of data that we have to like store away and cannot be used. In here, what we measure is actually we measure four things about the leukotriene pathway. We measure lipoxygenase, which is the enzyme that synthesizes leukotriene. we measure the leukodystrophin receptor, cystinine leukodystrophin 1, 2, and BLT2. So there are type of them. So in this case, we plot the graph like this. This line is represent the median, and this top on the box represents 75% and 25%. We also can show the max level and the minimum level. So I would like you to show you that we actually excited after finish this one. My master student on the beginning, when she thought that she have to work on meningioma, she was like, Achan, I'm going to be able to finish. I'm going to be to finish that. But at the end, her result is very impressive. This data is not published yet. It's actually in the process of writing. So here you can see that in the 5-lipo oxygenase, actually the median level are much higher. And also you can see that the max level is higher too. However, this is, we talk about humans, so there's a lot of variation. But after 24 pair, we actually can see that the level of 5-lipo oxygenase increase significantly in the tissue of the cancer. And the level of the receptor are increasing too. And the cis-LT2 actually linked to the anti-inflammatory effect. So we see a little bit decrease in terms of the level of cis-LT2. I would say that I'm confident in my data on 5-lipo oxygenase and cystinine leukodystrophin 1, because when we do PCR, right now people notice talking a lot on PCR after the COVID-19 that there's a cycle of it. So if they start in early enough cycle, usually people who do laboratory will really believe in them. So the level of cis-LT2 level is very low. The cycle are coming really at the end. And when you see the reduction, sometimes you actually not 100% sure behind the data, but there's some promising on that point. So after that, we tried to process the work on like Western blot and immunohistochemistry, but there are a lot of problems with that. So that's another protein receptor is BLT2. We found actually a little bit increase, but with Montelukast, which their target cystinine leukodystrophin 1 receptor. So we actually focus on 5-lipo oxygenase and cis-LT1. So what we get the tissue, what we can do beside the PCR is we can do something called Western blot. So this way we actually gonna measure the protein expression. So here we measure the 5-lipo oxygenase. So you can see that this is some representative data. We found the DURA one that have lower level than meningioma. One thing is that you showed here that I only got 12 pair. To get the RNA out of the tissue is very hard. To get the protein out of the tissue is even harder. But we could manage to get about 12 samples that are paired together. That means that we get both of the the adjacent tissue together with meningioma. We found that it actually increased. So that's something that we think are promising. And then what we process to do is we do the immunohistochemistry. In the DURA, we not be able to stain anything. When we do this technique on immunohistochemistry, if there are some protein, they will turn brown. So you see that some of the cell turn the brown color. So here, that's what something we think is quite interesting. And you're gonna see, if you go back to the data, see that I will show the level on 5-lipo oxygenase and also cystinine leukodystrophin 1. The pitfall of working on some of the protein is that you have to have great antibody with it. The problem with it is that we don't have great antibody for work on cis-LT1, so we'll not be able to do the Western blot, we'll not be able to do the immunohistochemistry. And for something like this, it actually have a same problem with other people, because when we try to search the paper, not a lot of people to do that either. So that's my research experience. The last part of it today is actually talking about what we do on the amniotic fluid. So this is a collaboration with Dr. Pia. So we start with the collecting the sample here, and it's sent to the regular like process that send sample to Chakrinarupadin. And what we do is we get the amniotic fluid. So the first thing when we start talking about is, let's measure the interleukin-6, that's what Dr. Pia want to see. And because my lab will usually do regularly interleukin-8 at the same time, I tell my student that that were, oh, okay, let's throw it in. And actually, you can actually see that we can measure interleukin 6 and interleukin 8. So here, this is very primarily at the beginning. So it was like, we're not sure that if the sample sent from Ramathibodi have to grow to the process about 2-3 hours, can we measure the level of the thing? Because previously what I work on is I actually like the sample got stored right away and get do it like quickly. But 2-3 hours or even 4-5 hours, usually I think is doable for some of, it's very doable for the clinical setting. We get some data, and usually another thing we try to record is how fast we can get the sample. But I think within the window of 4-6 hours, I think the data are reliable enough. So we have some 4 patients. So when we get it, we didn't know that they, Dr. Bia suspect inflammation or not. So you see that sample number 2 and number 4 have a very high level of interleukin 6 and 8. Actually, number 2 are really high. So I was really excited. So and later on, I checked the identification and we found that actually the 2 and the 4 actually have some report of suspect inflammation. One of the things is that I know it's very hard, but I'm sure that the clinician did the best, is that when we get amniotic fluid, sometimes we get some blood, like we see the dot of the red a little bit. That's mean there's some contamination with the blood. Sample number 2, actually there's some blood in the sample, not a lot. So I think that should not be a contamination from the blood. But when we do the research of this, we will note it for you guys. And also number 4, there's no blood in the sample, but you can see the level of interleukin 6 is quite like about 2-3 times higher than other sample. So this is something that we can measure. And also there's something that you probably be able to correlate with your clinical data that you have. So we measure the cytokine for this thing. And also I was seeing a lot of like quite several ml of the amniotic fluid. I only need for probably 1 ml for the ELISA. So I was like, actually there might be cell. And Dr. Bia said there are cell in the, she can get the number of the white blood cell in the sample. So it was like, let's try to do, maybe we can be able to separate the type of the cell, and maybe this can tell you and give the insight into the pathology. So what we do is we have 2 types of sample. We just start this one, and this one, we separate the sample into like the one we have a low white blood cell count and the one that the white blood cell count was more than 50. This what the clinical used to like cut off the like inflammation or not inflammation. That's what I gather for you guys. And here are the flow cytometry that we do. So I do would like to explain the data a little bit. So in here are the graph that we getting. So the difference between the top part and the bottom part is the top part, we didn't stain the cell with anything. We just collect the cell, spin it down, and actually like wash the cell and process into the flow cytometry. The bottom part, we actually stain with the some marker that we have. So in this case, because my lab was working on in the serum with other like crab later on the T cell. So we have some of the T cell marker on the lab. So it was like, let's stain T cell first, this marker that we have in the lab. So we have CD3, which is a marker of T cell. We have CD4 and we have CD8. So we can tell that this is a CD4 T cell or CD8 T cell. So in here, what we do is we actually gonna get, I'm not gonna show you the gating, but tell you what to do. What I'm doing is we get for CD3 first. So we take that if how much we have the CD3 in the population. And then from the population of CD3, we try to see that if it's CD4 or if it's CD8. So we get CD4 and CD8 after the CD3 population. So the top part, we didn't stain anything. The second part, we put all 3 antibodies into the same tube of the sample, of the specimen, and we just read out in different channels. So here, the first channel, we read out on the CD3. The middle panel, we read out on the CD4. And the right side one, we read out on the CD8. So when we get a sample with low white blood cell count, what we found that if we stain all these three, stain or non-stain doesn't look that much different. 2.0 or 3.5 are nothing. There probably some error because there's some sampling method too. So in here, we found that we don't be really detect lymphocyte if we have a really low white blood cell count. Another thing on y-axis, you see the number of the cells. So in terms of when we have low white blood cell count, we have like probably less than 100 cells to work with. So very low. So here, when we have sample with a higher white blood cell, so what we found that you can see that the count of the cell is very high. We get about like 1,000. My student was like, "Ajahn, finish really quick. If this on the left side," she said, "Oh my God, we might not have enough. We have to like several minutes per sample. If we have a lot of this, it's like 20 seconds, it's gone, it's finished." So here, we didn't stain anything. So we put the staining on. We found that in the population, we have a lot, like big group of the cell, about 30% might be lymphocyte. And in 30%, we try to separate to CD4 and CD8. About 70% probably be CD4 T cell. So if you see that they are showing the level of this marker, the curve will shift a little bit. So on the beginning, we will have to have non-staining first. Each of the patient have to do exactly the same because each of the patient are a little bit different in their cell population. So each of them, we first do non-staining and we put in this line to actually break down that, okay, if the level of the CD4 that we found is crossing this line, it's actually indicate that there's CD4 T cell. So we see that after we put the antibody in, about 70% probably likely to be CD4, and we measure CD8 is about 24%. So the number are quite interesting and it's quite like normal thing that we expect. We found like mostly CD4 and found some CD8. There are several types of T cell, but these two are the main population. This is very preliminary data and this is very interesting. And we think we're gonna try to do some neutrophil and macrophage too in the future, but we do have to do some, a little bit research first that which one we would like to do next. Dr. Bia, I have some question.
Yes, thank you, Ajahn Tan. Can I ask you, like, for example, if we get blood contaminations in our sample, so can you tell us, like, this is T cells from mother or this is T cells from fetus? How can you separate them?
That's the big problem, Dr. Bia. So when we get the blood contamination, we not be able to do this nice picture like this one. We'll not be able to tell this is T cell for amniotic fluid or T cell from the blood because the marker probably not be able to separate them enough. And also if we get the blood contamination, if we get a very nice amniotic fluid, the process is we just put antibody on and we put this into the flow cytometer and it read out very nicely. We get about two to three sample with this one already. Not as nice as this one because the beginning we have some like having to adjust it. But if we get the blood in the sample, the blood actually interfere with the flow cytometry on the first step. So what we have to do is we have to do something called red blood cell lysing. And after we put the red blood cell lysing on, which is like a gentle reagent, if we get a sample from plasma, it's fine. We can lyse the red blood cell out and we can do the white blood cell. They're not killing the cell, but probably there are a lot of cells to start with. But in amniotic fluid, we don't have a lot of cell. So if we put the lysing buffer on to actually eliminate some of the red blood cell that interfere with the flow cytometry, we lost all the cell. All the cell that we have is actually clump. And the distribution on the first step that we have to pinpoint, this is the population we want to select, is usually very difficult to getting. My research assistant who do this one, she was like, I'm not have a confidence to actually getting this one. So here, this is a problem, a limitation from flow cytometry. So a little bit of the blood can actually interfere with this research. And we're going to try to think on how to work on that. But at this point, I would say it's very hard because we put the gentle lysing buffer on and it actually killed the myba cell too. So is that okay with you?
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes I have to say that working with like researcher like me, I have to tell the doctor that sometimes we try to do our best, but we do have some limitation in the technique. And I understand that it do have some blood get in, but if it can get without the blood, actually we can actually separate better. We're going to try to do some monocyte and macrocyte, macrophage and neutrophil, and maybe it might be better, but my prediction is that we'll not be able to lyse the blood out of it because we tried one time already, two or three times already, I think two or three samples, and it all processed and we cannot be able to actually interpret the data. So this is something maybe exciting, but it's going to be more difficult to actually get the data to the point that we want. But it's not a lot of people can do this one. ELISA is quite easy. So compared to so tell you guys that one other thing is that maybe you can think about a project that can work with together. So ELISA is the sample that nice to handle because like if we get the fluid, we just only spin down and store it in the minus 80. And the sample are freeze well up to, I would tell you that when I do the stuff for my cell culture, actually I can freeze it up for 2 years. The reason I know that is good enough for almost 2 years because when we do some research, we get the result in the beginning, we process a lot of things, we submit the data, the result get back and we have to go dig through all the sample that we have. Some of them was almost 2 years. I was like, can we measure it? It's actually good enough if your freezer doesn't break down. So 1 to 2 years for ELISA sample is actually doable. This is easier, but a lot of people also do ELISA. So that's one of the things because it's easy. Flow cytometry, on the other hand, we have to have fresh specimen. One of the limitations we try is that you cannot predict when you're going to get sample, which is this is real life. That's why clinical setting was more valuable and they get some interesting data. So sometimes we get the specimen at the end of the day. And the process for this flow cytometry is about 3 to 4 hours. Usually if it go through very well, 2 hours is done. But when we think about 2 hours, usually it end up 3 or 4. Anyway, so sometimes we get it at the end of the day. It's difficult to process this thing. What we try is that we try to store the sample and read it next day. This is very doable for the blood sample. I'm do that when I was in my postdoc. We finish at the end of the day, we stain it, we fix it, we put it on the fridge, and tomorrow we can read it, no problem. But I think because of the cell in here is quite low, so the problem is that we try to do that the same way that I used to process the sample. We end up doesn't have a very nice peak. My research then said that we still get the peak, but I don't like it. So I think we have to actually process this fresh, meaning that if we get at the end of the day, if we would like to get the data, we have to process it. But like I said, I think this is like, if we can use work with it, we'll be able to tell you guys that, oh, in this patient, there's the activation of neutrophil and there's more of the lymphocyte. Maybe that can help you understand the disease better. So that's what we do. I actually talked about this already, is that some of the problem or some of the caution, like the blood in the fluid. So actually it interfere a little bit with this one. And I talk about vagina swab already, that something that I think I would like to try, but I have to think about carefully how I'm gonna, if I'm collaboration, I have to think about how much I can give the data back in the reliable that you can actually believe in the data. And also, like, I can tell you exactly that this is what happened. So something like amniotic fluid is very great because we have liquid that's unit of the measurement will be really like no reviewer will tell you that this is wrong. Like, this is probably you get the data wrong type or something like that. Another thing is time. Like, ELISA was nice. You can correct it and send to us anytime. And what I like to do and probably we will is like maybe we will try to put it on the room temperature or just on ice for several hours, maybe overnight, to see that if we can still get the good data as much as the sample we get within 4 to 6 hours. And if we want like to know the sum of the like the cells distribution, like I show you, the timing of the sample can be play a role. And this is actually have to work on my end that I would like to, I have to train some of my research assistant to work at the later of the night. But the difficulty of the lab research laboratory compared to the clinical, like the laboratory you use to send other staff with, that we don't have people work 24 hours. But this is some challenging. And when we try, when we get like nice data, we usually like to try to do it more and more. So I finished my talk right now. I thought I actually gonna finish quicker than this, but here is my contact. And thank you for your attention. If any one of you guys have some idea that you would like me to measure things, please contact me and we can talk about what we can do. And there's something that sometimes we do have to talk and we have to work it out. So that's all for the talk. And anyone who have a question, I welcome the question right now.
Yes,
thank you, Ajahn Pan.
สวัสดีค่ะใครก่อนค่ะ
ค่ะอาจารย์ชุติมานะคะ
ค่ะ
อาจารย์พลพันธ์ I have a question.I thinking about the brain PCR that you talk about in the beginning, that what do you think this is the cause of a fluctuation of data then when you try to measure the brain PCR?
One of the cause is probably each human have a different level. And also I think is we found that some people have like I think each of the person are not equally the same in the protein expression. And another thing is like, we have a big error bar due to like, even though we said that this tissue is non-cancerous adjacent tissue, but that's what the surgeon see in the, like under the operation. He also tell us that maybe there actually some of the cancer cell metastasis to that too. So that's why some of the sample is quite high on the adjacent tissue. We don't know how to correct this point. We try to get the pathology from each of the sample, but it's very difficult to talk to the pathology department. And also, I think they probably don't do the immunohistochemistry for the adjacent tissue. So with the brain tumor, we get something, we get something sometime like this tip of my finger, like very big one, big chunk. And some of the, sometime we get like a big one for the tumor, but for the adjacent tissue, sometimes we get something look like a strip of a thread. Like sometimes my student was like, I cannot see the sample. It's very small because like we should not cut a lot out of the patient. So I think it's difficult to actually process to do the immunohisto to pinpoint that they're actually a real non-cancerous tissue.
Right.
Another thing is that I think sometimes we do have to admit that we have the error on the timing, because the brain operation can be long. So sometimes the finish at the end of the day, and we try to talk the nurse that call us right away to pick up the sample. But what we found is actually sometimes the nurse, with all the coordination, we did not get the sample at the end of the day. We get it in the morning. So
right.
What the nurse mm-hmm. do is the nurse put it in the freezer, which like the regular fridge.
Oh no.
The regular fridge is about -4 or -5, but
yep.
the best way to store the RNA is actually -80. However, yeah. we do get some data out of that. So I think there's a role of like RNA degradation on that point too.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
If no one have any question, I'd like to carry on a bit. I just wonder how much that you can measure the level of by the level of the something that you want to measure by ELISA, because I have seen in the what is it in the leukin something that you propose is about picogram per ml, right? And can you go further down?
This is the limitation of the kit, Ajahn Chutima. So ELISA is the commercial kit. So for interleukin 6, I think there's a kit that can go lower than picogram, but some of the cytokine maybe not. And if you measure some like common cytokine, interleukin, the kit is not expensive. The kit works very well. If you work on some of like leukodein or prostaglandin, the kit can be really difficult to work on. And the detection right. limit may not be good sometimes. Mm-hmm. With the amniotic fluid, I would say for interleukin 6, actually, I had to dilute the sample, Ajahn Chutima.
I see.
So,
I just wonder, just in case that we can try to find some sample that maybe they have a really low level of the inflammatory level or something. And we have you ever deal with something with a HPLC to measure about the inflammation in the sample?
No, I would have to say no. So HPLC probably have greater like detection limit, but also we have to work on the which is like mobile phase of it.
Validation. So
we have to find yeah. validation yeah. and collection of mm-hmm. that point.
I know that it's not that easy before you're setting up in every test that you are going to run through. So and it should be the same way, and you are measuring by HPLC, because if you already validate in different time, maybe they cannot compare. So we need to work on it. No, that's all right. I just asking what you're doing right now. And another thing is, Ajahn Ponpan, please.
I would like to tell Dr. Chutima right now that there's another way that people like to measure the cytokine right now with flow cytometry. It's called multiplex setting. So what I'm doing is a regular classic ELISA.
Yep.
The reason is we have enough sample. And also from my experience, if you measure each one of them, you get better sensitivity. But I yep. do work on some of the sample that we have limited amount of the sample. So with mm-hmm. the limited amount of the sample, with the thing called multiplex, you can measure like 8, 10, 16 of the cytokine at the same time. For mm-hmm. me, we actually measure some of those in the lab. You mm-hmm. can see like the full chain, but some of the data have to be go through like some machine processing. For me, it's great for the exploratory, but if you have a pinpoint like candidate cytokine, I would suggest you measure one by one. Another mm-hmm. thing is that multiplex is super expensive, Ajahn Chutima. I have to tell you that I would, we do with one of the project, the one that we got from COVID patient. I would have to say that we have this is collaboration with Ajahn Natwood and one of my friend from the Faculty of Dentistry. We have to say that yeah. one plate costs 100,000 baht.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
100,000 okay. baht, and then 40 samples.
Ka. If I have another question, whether is it I am correct, so could you please just explain to me what is if we are going to do something about the inflammatory process or to check about the inflammation, should be the cells that they have a lot of proliferation or they have active rather than just only the tissue that just only like a fibrous tissue and they do stasis rather than have a division. Is it correct?
It's correct actually. The most cell that secrete those cytokine are in immune cell like macrophage. You can see that but the tissue will have some of the infiltrating macrophage. However, yeah. Like astrocyte that I work on, let's say 20 years ago, people think astrocyte is just the supporting cell, but right. We can prove that astrocyte released quite a bit of the cytokine, might not as much as the microglia in the brain, but they do. And even neuron actually release some of the cytokine, but not a lot. I have other project working on the cell right now. I put the cell same compound. If I put it on neuron, they will not release anything. I put it on astrocyte, I can see something. Yeah. So even though you think that you get some tissue, you might think there's low inflammation, but they might actually produce something. And there are a lot of research right now. We can start talking about this. We have to do some literature research that what people are doing. But I would say that if you get the tissue, you can get some information. I tell you that I work on breast cancer before, and when we get breast cancer, there are a lot of lipid. And yeah. With those sample, in the cancer not sample, even though we have some lipid, we still get higher level of the glutathione and we get higher level of MMP.
Okay, so I'm sorry, the last question, just a quick, how many cycles do you use for the 5-LOX?
5-LOX?
Yeah.
5-LOX actually a very great expression. Usually it quite be a while, but I think it's probably about 25 cycle. It's about 20 to 25, not bad at all. With CIS-LT1, mm-hmm. we actually get below 30 cycle. CIS-LT2 okay. that I said that I was not very confident in the data is usually below 35. And right. When you do PCR, usually we cut off at 40, but with all mm-hmm. this brain tissue, I tell my student to cut off about 45, give them a little bit extra. But how about how much we believe in the data? That's we have to set up the blank. So as yep. long as the blank doesn't come up, so that data can be used. But if the blank come up earlier than any of the cycle of your sample, we cut it off. We will report it as zero.
Right, right. Ajahn Pia, thank you very much, Ajahn Phorn Phan.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ajahn Phorn Phan. So if nobody has a question, we would like to thank Dr. Phorn Phan. And we hope that we can get a beautiful data and hope for future collaboration with you.
Yes, me too.
ขอบคุณค่ะ Ajahn Phorn Phan.
ขอบค
ุ
ณค
่
ะ
ขอบคุณค่ะ Interesting ค่ะได้ค่ะ
มีคนชื่อคุณหมออรวินหรือเปล่าคะยกมือหรือกดพลาดคะค่ะโอเคค่ะถ้าไม่มีคำถามก็ thank you for the listening and thank you for the great opportunity to share my research and I'm really excited to working on more of this thing is a new way of working for me but I think thatthe technique can apply to any of the organ. And in a way, I was thinking that I feel like I'm going back to work on cerebral spinal fluid again. So with a better information,
yeah,
because
yeah.
I think you have more amniotic fluid than the cerebral spinal
yeah,
fluid.
Yeah, of course.
It was like that yeah. when I was a postdoc, yeah. I have a project on cerebral spinal fluid to get like 3 ml. I was crying.
Yeah. Yeah, then, yeah.
เผื่อจะได้สามเป็นแม่หนูแทบร้องไห้เป็นนั่งขออยู่หน้าห้องหม
อขอบคุณนะ
ขอบคุณค่ะอาจารย์พรพันธ์ขอบคุณค่ะ
สวัสดีค่ะสวัสดีค่ะ